in your chakra.
Why haven't we done this challenge? Why haven't we done this challenge?
Could I pull off this challenge, first of all? That's the question you need to ask, Mople. Well, good evening, South Africa. It is Trending SA right here on SABC3. We are here to keep you company for the next half hour. I am Rithilwe, and on the table with me are my co-pilots. He is a straight shooter. He says it like it is. He appoints himself as the emperor of certain places. That's my Blair right there. Jean to Jean. Yeah, Jean on Jean. Looking good.
What's up, Mzansi? How are you doing?
And of course, on my right is my girl, Kapalma.
Why is he smiling at people like that?
Because he thinks he's like adorable. I don't know. Like Jedi mind trick them, you know?
Okay.
I'm gonna, but also, smile too. Just like show off that red
lip. I'm gonna laugh like this today.
Beautiful.
I wanna sound cute.
All right, guys, let's get straight into it. Whether you are chuckling at a sitcom or on TV, or you're just, you know, quietly giggling at a newspaper cartoon, laughing does you good. It is indeed the best medicine. But do you know what's not a joke? To make an audience of strangers laugh as a career. Mm-hmm. That is serious stuff.
Whether it's telling jokes or doing impersonations or sharing stories, a comedian has the toughest job. Today, we are hanging out with some of South Africa's comedians who've turned a passion into a livelihood.
Now, our first guest is a comedian who's described comedy as a personal art form, one that's informed by a point of reference and distinctive style. He first took the comedy scene by storm when he won the Comics Choice Award for Best Newcomer, and since then, he's just never looked back.
So this stand-up comedian is conceptual, authentic, and a creative powerhouse. From theatre, comedy, to TV and branded content, Ebenezer Dibagwane is doing it all, darling. Simply doing it all and leaving nothing to chance. It's no wonder that he's on an upward trajectory in his career. So please help me welcome to the show, comedy's very own Ebenezer. Thank you so much for coming. What gang is this?
I don't know, West Side. Also, just to correct people, I have looked back, like when I'm walking in Brio in town at night. You do look back sometimes, so to reflect upon the things that I might have achieved. But thank you. I appreciate you guys. That was well worded.
So, thank you for making the time. I imagine so many things to do. You're incredibly busy, but you chose to be on Trending SA.
Yeah.
Let's start from the beginning. You, I'm told, used to be or come from an evangelist background and used to be an evangelist. How in the world did you find your way to comedy and get here?
Or lose your way.
Or lose your way and get here.
And I think I used to be an evangelist, I used to preach the gospel. I came to Joburg and...
Lactate goal.
Sin is nice. Sin is nice. Leave the hype. Save me some monati. I'm joking. I'm kidding. No, man. I think, first of all, I began to question what God would be in terms of my own personal journey with them. I realized that it was more of a love sort of relationship. And my questioning also led me to kind of question more things about other things. Everything fell apart and I thought about how absurd life is. And I thought, let me take those absurdities or the way I see them onto the stage. Back to you.
Okay, so you were discovered at the Box Pop Art Comedy Club in Joburg, but that isn't the first audience that you work with.
No, not really.
Who's your first audience?
My first audience was my mom. I remember doing my joke and she was like, go to sleep. After that, no, we used to do skits at school, you know, we used to do some skits, dissing some of the teachers. And then also, I remember at school, I used to do this talent show. We were hosting a talent show and I used to throw in a keg or two.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Luiso Kola, who? I think I'm going to Joburg right now. And then I got to Joburg and I realized how much more difficult it actually is. And the legend is incredible. Yeah.
So, Mina, I want to talk to you about your style of comedy and influences. But before we do that, let's take a look at this.
See, I'm very crazy. I'm insane. But I'm serious. You know what I mean? I'm like Ebola. Remember when Ebola came out? That crazy. You remember when Ebola came out? Forget about AIDS! Forget about AIDS! I'm here!
So you said in an interview that the job of a comedian is to translate so that the audience, in spite of how different they are, gets the humor. How do you create that connection with your audience? And what topics are you always just gunning for?
So genuinely, I like to talk a lot about mental health. I like to talk about, I do talk about politics, I touch on it. But you see, again, you have to relate with the audience. If you're speaking to older people and you're like, you just told them you're 26 and you're telling them, but you guys ain't voting, right? Like, what do you know? So you have to have those considerations, you know? So for instance, if I'm playing to an older audience, I'll play the child thing and be like, criticize parenting. Okay. Or you guys say, because you know parents are like, oh, the children of today, they're not like us. Sure. I'm like, oh, somebody raised them. Maybe the parents of today are not like the parents of yesteryear. You know what I'm trying to say, right? So we play those angles. And if I'm in like a Vinek audience, generally a lot of Vinek audiences, they feel like you think you're better if you come at it in an English language, you know? So then I'd explain
Rufilo,
that.
Are you listening?
I'll explain that, you know, I speak English because of the way I grew up, you know? I relate to the people, and then we can speak about the jokes.
So,
with more taste, obviously.
With more taste. Let's talk about taste. An improvement, hopefully, right? You write, of course, write Bundy Hour skits, comedy. You are on stage, you're on screen. And I'm curious to find out if all these creative outlets and just these modalities are helping to improve your comedy, your stand-up specifically, you know, and how?
No, definitely. So the acting world, especially now that I've taken on more serious roles, you know, the acting, you're able to play a character, you know, suspend people's disbelief, you suspend it. So when the punchline comes, like for instance, that whole thing that I did now, just the, then I came to Joburg and sin is nice, you know, I have to be able to act and be in that moment. The audience mustn't be able to preempt what's going to happen. So that, the acting has helped in that. The writing, the pen is, you know, when you're exercising your pen and then all I have to do is translate it now. I'm writing it, I'm putting in more punchlines, more puns maybe, a scenario, more metaphors, colorful language. And then, you know, I'm able to take that offering, put it together and deliver it on the stage to the people, yes.
Okay, so 2021, what's on the horizon? What's on the agenda? What are you doing? What are you bringing?
So 2021, I'm going to be doing a few jobs. Of course, my one-man show, I'm Not Okay. I'll do it first. We're going to record it next year somewhere. And of course, there's a movie that we are releasing this coming year. It's going to be debuting at the Bioscope. Dates to come. Follow my Twitters and Instagrams. Run George is a film about a displaced Zimbabwean man who just simply can't catch a break. Essentially, think about the song as Ibhlungu Asipheli, but in Shona. Except I don't speak Shona, which is why this is a terrible log line. I'm going to phone the director. It's directed by V. Makausu, written by comedians Bongani Dube and Shanri van Veek, starring yours truly. I think it's going to be quite beautiful. It's a different comedy film. It's a dark comedy. And we're looking forward to sharing that with you guys.
We're looking forward to seeing it. Thank you
so much, my guy, for coming through. So we're going to go to a quick ad break. And when we come back, we've got the incredible Donovan Goliath. Don't go anywhere.
And then we'll have your comedy, Zach.
We have Elma dissing Rufilo. That's beautiful. Welcome back. You're still tuned into Training SA.
Why do you like fight so much, Maple? We're literally just discussing facts.
Okay. It wasn't even a diss.
He carries around a little spoon and he just stirs every chance he gets.
Our next guest is easily a creative genius. If you don't believe me, then you need to just hop over to his social media pages and you will know why. If that doesn't do the job, then his list of accolades, including comedy shows, TV work, MC gigs, advertising and copywriting surely will do the job.
He has firmly, and I mean firmly, positioned himself as one of the leading comedians in the country with huge audience base that's both diverse and eclectic. Donovan Goliath has over the years proven why he is a force to be reckoned with, and he brags different because he calls, you know, Missy Elliott his number one fan. Donovan Goliath, welcome to Training SA. Look at you.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. You know what? I need guys like you to follow me everywhere. You know, when somebody goes, hey man, what's your name? I'm just going to go, Rufilwe, my blood.
Listen, I will be your praise. Nice. I will be your praise singer, Donovan, for a healthy sum. Yeah? We'll discuss all of that after the show. But let's talk about the fact that this pandemic has obviously been incredibly tough on all of us, but you managed to find humor, entertain us with your partner, Davina. You really got us through some really tough moments. But let's get personal.
Thank you.
Was your year in lockdown?
You know, and I hate to say this because it sounds weird and it sounds so unfair, but 2020 is probably the best thing that could have happened to me as a creative person, as somebody who's been wanting to like really put out as many ideas as possible for the longest time. But you know how imposter syndrome works and how society always boxes you and says that you should only be one thing and you can't be doing all of these other things, blah, 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 blah. Yeah. But Annelem Doda actually framed this really well. And she said that it seems like the captivity gave you freedom. And that's the most accurate description of my year, you know, is I got to a point where, you know, Davina and I were here and I was like, well, we're not going to be on stage for the longest time, probably for the next year or so. So I'm not the kind of person who just sits back and does nothing. I'm always working. It doesn't matter what it is. I'm always trying to do something, always trying to make something. So when we were all forced to stay at home, that was the best time for me just to go, here's the chance to entertain myself. And to entertain my audiences since I can't be on stage. And it's the first time Davina and I actually collaborated and just kind of joined forces. She brought me into her world. I brought her into my world. And we just created this new thing. And we were so grateful, you know, that people took to it. And it's still going, which is amazing.
So you and Davina, it works. It just works.
Yeah.
What makes her the best collaborator? What, like, it seems like it's a match made in heaven.
You know what? I'm going to take it one step back and not just say what makes the best collaborator. What makes her the best partner for me is, man, you know, we're like, we just get each other. You know, we share the same humor, the same sarcasm. You know, we can be on opposite ends of a room, but just look at each other when there's like a personal joke that we're sharing. If there's somebody on the other side of the room who maybe has like a big ears, whatever it is, you know, and then we just kind of look at each other and we've got that thing where we just connect, you know, it's that. So, you know, when we're pitching ideas or coming up or brainstorming with one another, it just kind of flows. I know what she's going to like. She knows what I'm going to like. And we kind of respect each other's spaces and ideas as well. So if one person doesn't like anything or thinks that something's weird or something's off, boom, you're going to say it. You're not just going to do it to let the other person fly, you know, because we know that it's we're putting ourselves out there together. So each one of us has to benefit here. So you're always keeping each other in check because the strength is in the team.
So the strength is in the team in this case, certainly. What has been interesting, one of your strengths that has stood out for me is the way that you don't only make content that your audience love, you have you have really done branded content well. How do you make branded content that doesn't annoy your follower? What is the secret?
The secret is to, look, I think I've got a little bit of an unfair advantage there because I worked in advertising for 7 years. I was an art director at a big ad agency. So I know how to kind of tell stories and put visuals together in a way, in a very consolidated way, you know, using very basic resources. But the trick with that is convincing the brand that they can't overbrand. You know, you've got to remove as many logos as possible and allow people to buy into what we are trying to sell them. Let them buy us first and almost make it incidental where you sneak the brand in. And we've been lucky, you know, people have listened and, you know, we've done some amazing collaborations with some brands. We were actually so surprised that they just allowed us to be us. And that's the power, you know, the moment you get somebody just because they've got a very high following and they've got nothing to do with what you're trying to sell or what you're trying to communicate, it's going to fall flat from the get-go because people are smart now, you know, they see right through it, they can see an ad a mile away. So it's honestly stripping it down to the basics and making it look as close to that person that you've hired to follow as possible and not make it feel like the brand is involved here in any way. And people always appreciate it. They always appreciate brands that are brave enough to allow the creator to create.
Definitely. I absolutely love the character that you play. Let's take a look at the acclaimed film critic, De Laster Hond.
Welcome to the adventures of De Laster Hond, who is me. So the other day, my bro, I was watching this other film, Dirty Dancing. Have you seen it? It's about this other bro, Patrick Swayze. He's got to teach this other lady how to dance, but she's tough, my bro. She dances next to the music. But anyway, he teaches all kinds of moves. Mambo, tango, tomato and onion salsa, everything. If it was nowadays, he would have even taught the Jerusalem dance, even me, bro. Then they do this other move, ne, where she must run there in the water. Then he picks her up and he holds her.
How do you actually come up with these characters? And how do you remember their traits? Because they all have little quirks.
Yes. Okay, so my thing on stage, like, you know what, to take it all the way back once again, where this comes from is I've always been good at impersonation. So my sister and I, you know, she's also very good at impersonating people. So when we were growing up, we would sit in the room while my parents were with, you know, the older family members or friends or whatever it is, and we would kind of mimic their conversations, you know, like impersonate them, and they were in another room. And I think that's where it came from. That was my thing. I was always that kid at school, you know, who wanted the center of attention, always trying to like pick up on little mannerisms here and there. And that's my thing on stage right now. So like my entire set on stage is really made up of different characters. I really enjoy this idea of kind of painting this image, you know, like kind of making people visualize everything that I'm talking about. So there's a lot of detail, you know, it's not just the accent, it's the mannerisms, it's this, it's that, and how does this person walk? What are they wearing? How does the place smell? You know, wherever they are, what is the lighting? I really want to put you there. And this character actually, Dilasta Haunt, is inspired by a guy in PE, because I studied there. He was a pimp on the side of the road, and he called himself Dilasta Haunt. So I just thought about him and his mannerisms and then juxtaposed it with something that is completely left field, which is being a movie reviewer. And you mesh those two together, you're going to form something very, very interesting, you know? And that's how jokes are often formed. It's like, it's the amalgamation of two very opposing ideas to create this whole new world. And that's how Dilasta Haunt came about.
Donovan, before we let you go, I need to find out if you are ever going to follow your true calling, which is to become a rapper, because your Kendrick Lamar impersonations are just phenomenal.
You.
And I want to take a quick moment to just play a video. Yep. Let's check this out.
Walked outside the door, in the cold, hit my soul. I'm pretty old, but my mama still telling me, can we get the cold, you can catch a cold. I know it's Game of Thrones, Jon Snow wouldn't last at all. Winter in the city of gold, I kept a girl, not because I don't love her, but because of my shrinking balls.
Why are you depriving us? I mean, what are you doing? What are you waiting for already?
You feel like, you know what? I used to be a rapper, Imtar Dunham. I was part of a group called Outbreak.
Were you deep in the cypher with the other kids?
I was that guy. I won Mr. Sales House or whatever. So I rapped and then I got to model. And I won this backpack with like crayons and underwear and like 10 of deodorant or whatever it is. It was like this weird talent show. So, yeah, we had this rap group. My alias was Acid Rain. And... No, there were three of us. Guys, we were the real deal.
Yes.
Mr. Sales House, Acid Rain in the house. It was great to have you. Donovan, all the best for 2021. It was great to catch up with you. We can't wait to see what else comes out of that brilliant line. Trending is coming back shortly. Don't go far. Guys.
Okay, let's do it like this. I need money, trees, and summer breeze. Lot of cheese.
What do you need, Alma? What do you need?
Yeah.
I just need nice weather, please.
I'm asking for too much.
Can it not rain when my hair looks nice, please?
Well, welcome back to Ta on 3, and it's been an absolute pleasure being on your screens this year. It really has. But before we sign out, we still have another lit show tomorrow, so it's not quite over. But most importantly, we are now joined by one of our national treasures.
Mojack Lehoko has graced various stages across South Africa and abroad. After starting his career as a stand-up comedian, he went on to write for the satirical news show Late Night News with Luis Ogola, which garnered critical acclaim and multiple international Emmy Award nominations. He's also a multiple Comics Choice Awards nominee and winner, MC and actor. Welcome to Trending SA, Mojack.
Hi, thank you for having me. This is nice. I like what you've done with the place.
Absolutely nothing, in other words.
That's my point. It's great. Oh, wow.
Just, before we go too far.
Just new furniture, you know, us.
We were all creative during lockdown.
Yes.
We were baking, mm-hmm. trying to get our fitness game on.
Yes.
Some with no success.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And this is what you were doing.
Xefede, ngisekhrontshini nemeli sithenga ispinza earlier, angisho bo my level 2, so pshaya later. Stay tuned.
Julia, how's it, Oaks? Yo, just a quick update, chilling with my birds. I'm gonna have a dope later with my lady. Yo, love it over here. So that's gonna let you know, it's alright.
So on top of all of this,
yes.
On top of all of this,
yes.
You were also learning French. Well, how's that going?
Terribly. It's going. It might be worse than when I started, to be honest. I had done French in varsity with my older brother, mm-hmm. and then I tried to pick it up again, but I just forget the words all the time.
What, yeah. Why French?
It's a very broadly spoken language. So I know basic. Bonsoir, ça va, je m'appelle Mojak, j'habite en Johannesburg, je travaille en training essay. So I know like the basic stuff. Oh.
So your YouTube show, Tell Us More, with Mojak. I just want us to watch a little bit of it and we'll discuss it. Yeah?
I mean, you're talking now about like people pitching ideas to you. What's the craziest thing? Because like often we'll meet someone who's like, man, I did a show in Mpumalanga, put me on at Blacks Only. Then you're like, whoa, like, I just met you.
Yeah, I guess people don't have the, I never had that though. I never had this sense that I could just walk up to, like, I don't know who has been, Oskido. I don't know who would have been like a guy I saw on TV and sure. said, yo, I've got a thing. I don't know. Maybe I didn't have the opportunity. Maybe there was no.
So why a YouTube show? I mean, is there something that you're trying to drill down into and capture?
So initially, the Tell Us More is a podcast, which is basically I like knowing why people do things. And mm-hmm. so often whenever I hear something that sparks an idea, I'm like, hey, tell us more.
Sure.
Started off, it currently exists on Spotify and iTunes. And then, of course, because of lockdown, I was recording it at home. Mm. And that was not possible. So I decided, my friend Wade Rose, who's a graphic designer, we were kind of broadcasting remotely. His bedroom was like our HQ, our control room. I was at home with my camera and my setup. And then I had people who I really liked, whose stories I wanted to know more about. So that Kagiso Ledikas Kumba was on. I had Pippa Shabalala, who is in gaming. She's incredible.
Really
Mansur Pout. Yeah. So many wonderful people whose stories I'm intrigued by. And I wanted to know, like, tell me more. How did you get to where you are at the moment?
Yeah. Yeah. Really, really quickly, there's no doubt in my mind that you started making some kind of New Year's resolutions. What is top three on that list?
One, don't catch corona. Two, don't catch corona. Three, don't catch COVID-19. That's the variation of corona. No, I'm just trying to stay healthy and have fun with my family and do what I can in these difficult times. And don't be broke. I'm tired of being broke.
Cashless society.
I'm good, guys. I'm really
Mojak,
good.
It's been a blast. Thank you so much for hanging out with us. And guys, that's how we wrap it up right here on Tsar on 3. You know what to do tomorrow. Same time, same place, 6 p.m.
Don't get COVID.